Welcome to worship here at Good Shepherd Online. Our first song today will be This Is Amazing Grace.
You've done for me. You've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquers the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquers the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah, this is amazing grace.
When we gather together, wherever we are scattered, we know that God meets us. And so we take a moment to do this assessment of how are we feeling distant from God? What have we said or done to others that maybe has put a wedge in our relationship? What are those assumptions we're making that we should check out first before we jump to a conclusion? Let's take a moment to do that now and then hear a word of healing and hope. Wherever you are in this world or in your relationship to God or one another, know that Jesus is at work, that Jesus is forgiving you and is bringing you new life. In the name of Jesus, your sins are forgiven. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you that when we come to worship, we encounter you, that you are present with us, that you shape us, that you fill us, that you lead us from this place. Dear God, help us not to lean on our assumptions about you, but that we could learn who you truly are so that we could be shaped by that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our gospel passage this week is from Mark chapter 2. When Jesus returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many gathered around that there was no longer room for them, not even in front of the door, and he was speaking the word to them. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And after having dug through it, they let down a mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak in this way? It is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" At once, Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions among themselves. And he said to them, "Why do you raise questions in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up and take your mat and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." This was from Mark chapter 2. So what do the following six sayings have in common? Number 1, God will not give you more than you can handle. Number 2, God helps those who help themselves. Number 3, everything happens for a reason. Number 4, God just wants you to be happy. Number 5, God only takes the best. And number 6, if your faith is strong enough, nothing bad will ever happen to you. Do you know what these sayings have in common? None of them are in the Bible. Today, in our Who Told You That series, we are looking at how assumptions impact our faith. An assumption is an unexamined belief. It is something that you accept as true without questioning or proof. We all have some beliefs that are based on what we have heard from others without digging into the Bible and examining them for ourselves. Sometimes a saying is spoken so many times that you assume it is in the Bible. Or you hear other Christians, people that God loves, say hateful things, and you think that it must be in the Bible, or that they represent Christianity. Late pastor Tim Keller said, "Christianity does not set faith against thinking. It sets faith against assuming." Sometimes when I talk to people who struggle with faith, I find that the thing they have trouble swallowing is something I don't believe about God either. So what do? We go to the source, the messy and beautiful source called Scripture, and we read it and wrestle with it and ask the same question that a monk named Martin Luther asked 500 years ago. What is God saying to us today? That is actually two questions. The first question is this God's word for us or for other people? And is it God's word for one point in time or for us today too? We don't throw out any of the Bible, but we encounter God more fully when we're willing to ask those deeper questions. Martin Luther used the example of the Ten Commandments to show how one commandment applied to people of an earlier time and not to his time. The command says that we are not to covet our neighbor's wife or cattle or anything that belongs to our neighbor. Martin Luther, already in the 1500s, pointed out that women were seen as property in Old Testament times and not as citizens. He said that coveting is against God's law. But we adjust how we look at this command in light of women being seen as human. Martin Luther also reminds us that all the laws in the Old Testament shared God's ways of governing until the time of Jesus. And now in this time, we follow Jesus and not a set of laws or commandments or ordinances. I shared an interaction in Mark chapter 2 at the beginning of this message. It's one of my favorite interactions with Jesus. Four friends bring their paralyzed friend to Jesus. And when they can't get through the crowd, they bring their friend to Jesus through the roof. And when Jesus sees their faith, he heals their friend. This is toward the beginning of the gospel, according to Mark. And already, Jesus has made quite a splash. So far, in chapter 1, Jesus has been baptized by John the Baptist. He has cast out an unclean spirit out of someone in the temple. He has done some teaching in a way that his audience had never heard before. He heals Simon's mother-in-law. He heals a whole bunch of people outside of Simon's house. And then he touches a leper and heals him. This is just in chapter 1. People are just getting to know Jesus. They are intrigued, and everyone is making assumptions about him. What assumptions are the people making about Jesus in this scene? The scribes, people who write down the religious laws, are quick to be offended by Jesus, and they don't want him saying anything that undermines their power. Their assumptions cause them to be defensive. The four friends who bring a paralyzed man on a stretcher have other assumptions. Maybe they were in the crowd of people who came to Jesus for healing, and based on what they saw, they assumed that he could heal their friend. But they got more than they bargained for. They were just seeking physical healing for their friend. But Jesus also spoke words of spiritual healing to him. Your sins are forgiven. They didn't realize that Jesus had the power to heal body, mind, and spirit. This filled them with awe, but it filled the religious leaders with anger. For us not to make assumptions, let's look at what Jesus actually says. He says to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." He asks the scribes, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts?" He says to the formerly paralyzed man, "Stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." Jesus speaks words of healing for this man's body and soul. He tells this man to go back to his home to be reunited with his family. Jesus shows that he cares not just about this person's holistic healing, but also his connection to others. Jesus shows that he is willing to heal someone based on the faith of their friends. We have no idea if the paralyzed man had faith, but Jesus could see how much his friends cared for him. Our faith can impact others too. Our faith isn't just for us. In the next scene that I didn't share with you today, Jesus gets in trouble again. He calls Levi, a tax collector, to be one of his followers. And then he goes and eats at Levi's house. And the scribes and Pharisees are busy making assumptions and asking why Jesus hangs out with sinners and tax collectors and eats with them. Assumptions are powerful. They can hurt people and damage their faith. A whole generation of young people are watching us and are forming their faith partially based on what they see us say and do. Barna Research has been tracking the beliefs of each generation for decades. And they find that a big obstacle for younger people being engaged in church is when younger generations assume Christians are judgmental and hypocritical. Many young people can say what their churches are against more fluently than what they can say their churches are for. But these same young people are still interested in learning more about Jesus. Our focus here needs to stay on Jesus, on what he actually said and did. Confirmation students who are in middle school and high school ask a lot of questions in sermon notes. Some of them want to know what Christians believe about God or what God thinks. Does God hate gay people? Does God hate science? Does God hate people who are divorced? It boils down to, does God hate me? Am I and my friends accepted by God, worthy of this holistic healing that Jesus offers? In Julie's children's message in church this week, she shares some truths about Jesus. What Julie and other leaders tell kids matters. Our hope is that our words move people toward Jesus. Our hope is that people of every generation meet Jesus in church and in scripture and wrestle with his words for themselves. The gospel books are a great place to start. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These are four accounts of Jesus's life written by people connected to the early followers of Jesus. In these books, you get to hear and see what Jesus says and does so that your faith is built on tested truths and not on assumptions. So you know what they say about making assumptions? My answer is that assumptions lead us not to hear, not to listen to, or to receive the power and presence of Jesus. Let's truly listen and lean into the Word of God to hear that Jesus is for us, for this world, for our healing, for our connection to one another. Amen.
As we continue our time of worship, let's pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our next song is No Outsiders.
You are a refuge, you have no borders. When I was a stranger, knocking at your door, you took me in with no questions and no conditions. When I was a sinner running from your grace, you called me friend. And there are no outsiders to beyond the waves, you calm the storm. And you are the grace enough. And I was thrown upon your shores. I was homeless and afraid till I heard you call my name. Now I'm ransomed, I'm restored, resurrected. I am yours. I am loved. Yes, I belong. For my soul has found its home. There are no outsiders to your love, and we are all. When I have wandered, Lord, your cross is the open door. There are no outsiders. I'm not an outsider. No, there are no outsiders to your love. And we are all welcome. There's grace enough. And when I have
we want to thank you for being a part of this worshiping community where together we are encountering Jesus. And we also invite your participation. We love to have you participate in all the things that we do here, but that also requires resources. It is all of our resources together that can fuel the things that we do in this building for worship and education and knowledge of Jesus. But your resources shared with this church also help us reach out beyond the walls of this community to reach people who are in need of very basic things like housing and food and someone to share that they care about them. So thank you for being a part of giving to Good Shepherd. Everything that we gather together matters. We've got some great ways to connect as we get into this second half of summer. So we want you to check out all of these things that we're listing on the screen. And if you live in the area, please invite your friends, your families, your neighbors. We would love to have you participate in the ways that we gather, grow, and go. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.